بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. Dear and respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Today we are talking about the love that we must have for our beloved Prophet, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are talking about mahabbatu Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, loving the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ahzab, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ وَأُولُو الْأَرْحَامِ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلَى بِبَعْضٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ إِلَّا أَنْ تَفْعَلُوا إِلَى أَوْلِيَائِكُمْ مَعْرُوفًا كَانَ ذَلِكَ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَسْطُورًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this ayah, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ, which means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should have more rights on ourselves than our own selves, meaning that we should prioritize Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over everything, including ourselves. This is what Allah azza wa jalla is telling us. An-nabiyyu awla bil mu'minina min anfusihim. And this is why it came in the authentic hadith narrated by Imam al-Bukhari alayhi rahmatullahi ta'ala, when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, la anta ahabbu ilayya من كل شيء إلا من نفسي. Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu thought that he was saying something good, something exceptional, something positive. He said, Ya Rasulullah, can you imagine this? You are more beloved to me than everything, than anyone and than everything except myself. Meaning you are number two. I love myself the most and then I love you, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was surprised to learn from the answer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that this was not enough. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, لَا وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ حَتَّى أَكُونَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكَ مِن نَفْسِكَ. He said, no, by Allah, until I become more beloved to you than your own self, meaning you have to love me more than you love yourself, because I am Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because I am the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he got the point, he understood that this was required for our iman to be truthful. We have to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than everything and anyone. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, wallahi la anta ahabu ilayya min nafsi. O Prophet of Allah, now I love you more than everyone and everything, including my own self. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told him, Al-ana ya Umar. Now, Ya Umar, meaning now you said it right. Now you have said the truth. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants us to accomplish. And this is the level that we should be aiming for. And this is why also it came in a different hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من ولده ووالده والناس أجمعين أو من والده وولده والناس. He said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, none of you will truly believe until I become more beloved to him than his parents, as well as his children, as well as everyone else, all of mankind. We have to love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than everybody else. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also, it came in the other hadith narrated by Imam Muslim alayhi rahmatullahi ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about طعم الإيمان, the taste of Iman. How can we taste faith? The concept of faith in Islam is not something that represents a simple identity. You just say it with my tongue. I say I am a mu'min, I have Iman. This is not what Iman is limited to in Islam. Iman actually has an experience, it has a taste to it when it is truthful. So he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the authentic hadith, ذَاقَ طَعْمَ الْإِيمَانِ مَنْ رَضِيَ بِاللَّهِ رَبًّا وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا وَبِمُحَمَّدٍ رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said عليه الصلاة والسلام, the person who will, or this person or that person, or he will taste the taste of iman, he will experience the taste of iman, he who accomplishes or who has, who owns these three elements, these three characteristics. He says عليه الصلاة والسلام من رضي. So رضي means to be pleased, to be satisfied. So of course, the moment we talk about رضا, رضي, we are talking about what? Love. Because you cannot be satisfied about something, you cannot be happy and content with something if you do not love that thing. So love is included within a رضا, or being content and satisfied and pleased. So pleased with what? Content with what? He said عليه الصلاة والسلام من رضي بالله ربا. First of all, to be pleased and satisfied with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a Lord, as a Rabb. Meaning, you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is enough for you. When I know that Allah Azza wa Jal, I am pleased, for example, with His will, with His qadr, with whatever He created and He made and He gave for me and for other people. So this is called what? Ar-ridha biqadri Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, accepting and being happy and pleased with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This also implies being pleased with the shara of Allah Azza wa Jal, meaning with the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His laws. So we see a lot of people nowadays, they say that they are Muslimin, they claim to have Iman, and they say Alhamdulillah, and they say we have to be grateful and thankful and to love Allah Azza wa Jal for things that He gave us and so on and so forth. However, they do not accept the Sharia of Allah Azza wa Jal. They do not accept the Shara, the Ahkam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah Azza wa Jal says this is halal or this is haram or this is a condition to that, they say, but why? I do not necessarily agree with this. I'm not convinced by this. So this is not رَضِيْتُ بِاللَّهِ رَبًّا. So first of all, being satisfied and pleased with Allah Azza wa Jal as a Rabb, as a Lord. Second, he says عليه الصلاة والسلام وَبِالْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا. To be pleased and satisfied and content with Islam as a religion. You are not looking for another manhaj, you're not looking for another way of life to add with Islam, to merge with Islam. You are not, for example, like some people, again, some people claim to be Muslimin nowadays, they do, they try to adjust Islam, to come up with a new version of Islam that makes them happy, because they're not really happy with Islam that Allah Azza wa Jal has revealed in the Quran, or that can be found in the hadith, in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they want some adjustment, some updating to it. So this is not raditu bil Islam deena. And then number three, he says alayhi salatu salam wa bi Muhammadin rasula, to be pleased with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a rasul, meaning as a messenger of Allah alayhi salatu salam. You love the path of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is enough to you as a role model. This is when you will experience what? The taste, ta'am al-iman, the experience or the taste of iman. We have also another similar hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ بِهِنَّ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. There are three characteristics, again, three elements, that if you get all of them, what will happen? You will taste the sweetness of Iman. Now the Prophet ﷺ, he is describing what is the taste of Iman. Iman is sweet. So to be able to experience again the sweetness of Iman, we have three things that are required that we have to accomplish. We have to get to that level, inshaAllah Azza wa Jal. He says, عليه الصلاة والسلام, مَنْ كَانَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا سِوَاهُمَا. First of all, that you love Allah and His Messenger ﷺ more than everyone else. أحب إليه مما سواهما. Number two, وأن يحب المرء لا يحبه إلا لله. To get to the point where you actually start loving other Muslimin only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So usually people, they, when they love someone, they are either attracted by some masalih, some interests, for example, the ideas of that person, money. So nowadays we have this a lot. People, they love you for interests, for money, for example, for business. The moment they get what they wanted to get, they will turn against you. This is not what true brotherhood is, by the way. And it's very unfortunate here that some Muslimin, again, they use that, you know, that keyword, which is akhi fillah, akhi, my brother, we are brothers in Islam, but they only bring it to you when they want to get something from you, something from the dunya from you. So they would go, for example, to a Muslim businessman, enter a Muslim store, for example, example, start bargaining on the price. And then he says, but we are ikhwa, you are my akhi, we are brothers in Islam. And then the moment he gets what he wanted to get, he forgets that ukhuwa, what he claimed to be ukhuwa, brotherhood. This is not sincere brotherhood. We are talking here about truthful brotherhood, meaning even if you're not getting anything from that person, you have nothing in common with them except Islam, you love them for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's the second characteristic here, second criteria, second condition. Before we achieve again, before we are able to taste the sweetness of Iman. And then he says, عليه الصلاة والسلام, وَأَنْ يَكْرَهَ أَنْ يَعُودَ فِي الْكُفْرِ بَعْدَ أَنْ أَنْقَذَهُ اللَّهُ مِنْهُ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَنْ يُقْذَفَ فِي النَّارِ. And that he dislikes, he hates going back to kufr, leaving Islam. When someone truly loves Islam to the point that they would never accept leaving Islam for anything, they would not give up on Islam, even during hardships, even if it is suggested to them that, you know what, you can maybe leave Islam just for a day, just for a week, just for a year, just to be able to accomplish some of the things, you know, that Islam might seem like an obstacle, you are not able to accomplish them. So just go out of Islam. When we say go out of Islam, it doesn't mean necessarily, you know, I'm leaving Islam, bye-bye. No, sometimes it's giving up on the principles, the major principles of Islam. For example, stopping Salat and stopping the Quran and so on and so forth. And then even if that is suggested to the person, he says, عليه الصلاة والسلام, كما يكره أن يقذف في النار. He gives the example here of if you are offered to throw yourself in the fire. So imagine if they tell you, what if you throw yourself in that? What if you throw yourself, just jump into that fire, and then after this, we will pay you, we will give you a job, we will help you, you will become famous, for example. Well, most people, 99.99999% of people will say, you know, this is a big no, this is super frightening. Who would accept to do that? He says, alayhi salatu salam, the one who experiences halawat al-iman will have the same reaction if ever the thought of leaving Islam comes to them. And here I want to mention a story. Actually, there's an imam, a sheikh in our city. He said that once, subhanAllah, I'm just giving this story here just to illustrate what it means here, the opposite, meaning what is the wrong practice here that we should not be doing to be able to get to what the Prophet ﷺ want us to achieve. Well, this is what is not to do. So we have to know in Islam what is to do, and we have to also understand what is not to be done. So one of the mashayikh, one of the imams in our city, he was telling us once that a Muslim, quote unquote here, Muslim came to his office and he said, "Ya Sheikh, I have a question for you. Fatwa, talab fatwa. I want to have a fatwa. I want you to give me an answer. Is it halal or haram?" He said, "What is the situation? What is the matter with you?" He said, "I do not have papers in this country, so I am an illegal person. I don't have my papers. I don't have citizenship. I don't have the right to stay here, so I might get deported at any moment." He said, "I went to an immigration lawyer, and he told me that you have one very easy solution, and it might be the only solution for you if you want to stay in this country, if you want to live in this country forever." He said, "What is the solution?" He said, "You know what? You're just going to write a false testimony, you're just going to make up a story, and you're going to say, I was an Arab Muslim that comes from an Arab country. However, in my country, I left Islam. I decided to leave Islam. I did not like the religion of Islam anymore. And because of that, people threatened to kill me. So I felt threatened, very seriously threatened in my life, and that's why I came to this country. So I should be accepted as a refugee because I flew, you know, to protect my faith. This is my religion, freedom." So the lawyer told him, "If you write this story, for sure, I guarantee to you that the judge will give you your papers and will allow you to stay in this country." Now, what is amazing is not the idea that comes from the lawyer, is a kafir, of course. What is amazing here is that someone who calls himself a Muslim even has the thought of coming to the sheikh, to the imam in the masjid, to ask him, "Ya sheikh, is it legal, is it halal for me to do something like this? Can I basically write that I have left Islam? Can I basically tarnish the image of Islam and of the Muslimin just for the sake of getting my papers. This is kufr, of course. There is no doubt about this. Iyadu billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. But how can someone who truly experienced or who has truly experienced the sweetness and the taste of faith even or ever imagine doing something like this? Iyadu billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now we have a few stories here. I just want to mention actually one story from the life of the Sahaba, companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because you know what? If we start talking about the love of the Sahaba, how much they had, how much they loved the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this will not end. We will be talking for hours and hours and hours. But there is a very famous story that during the Battle of Badr, during the famous Battle of Badr, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if I remember correctly, it was either a few hours or maybe the night before the actual battle happened, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was getting his troops, his soldiers ready. So he was making sure that their lines are straight. You know, any commander usually during war, during battle, is going to check on the soldiers, make sure that they are well structured, well organized, the rows and the lines are straight, just like we do in Salat usually. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went to them and he had some kind of, they call it al-qidh in the Arabic language. It was like it's like a stick or some form of an arrow, but that is not super pointy or doesn't injure others and so on and so forth. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going through the rows and telling, you know, you go back a little bit, you come front a little bit, and he was pointing like this with that stick or something that looks like a stick. And he was doing this with his Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. When he got to this Sahabi by the name of Sawad ibn Ghaziyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, one companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his name was Sawad ibn Ghaziyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Sawad, he was a little bit forward, so he was a little bit out of the line. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as it came in the hadith here and it came in the authentic narration, ta'anahu. When you do ta'an here, it is like poking someone. So imagine again, if you have a stick like this and you just very slightly you poke someone, you say go back. So go back, move back, take one step back. So that Sahabi, he surprised the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he surprised the rest of the Sahaba who were standing around when he told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Awja'tani ya Rasulullah, awja'tani, you've hurt me ya Rasulullah, fa waqad ba'athaka Allah bi al-haqqi wa al-'adli fa'aqidni." He said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, Allah azza wa jalla, has sent you with a religion of truth and justice. You are the Prophet of truth and justice, so I want justice to be made." Basically, he's telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because you hurt me, it's my right here to take the very same stick and to do the same thing to you, ya Rasulullah. This is what we call here al-qisas. Qisas is when you get your right back the same way that someone hurt you, then you have وَجَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةٍ سَيِّئَةٌ مِثْلُهَا, as Allah azza wa jal said in al-Qur'an al-Kareem. Now, of course, yes, Islam is the religion of truth and justice, and even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he applies justice on his own self. Alayhi salatu wasalam, he didn't say, "How dare you say this to me? I am Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." But still, this was pretty surprising. How can a Sahabi, usually in our own life, even sometimes, let's say your own father, your own mother, sometimes, says one excessive word to you. If your mom or your brother or your father pokes you like this very slightly, even if it hurts a little bit, but you're not going to tell your mother, for example, or your father, "I want justice to be made." Okay, even if you know or think that they might have been wrong, they didn't have the intention to be wrong, but they did hurt you. Now, so this was very surprising to the Prophet ﷺ and to the rest of the Sahaba. But the Prophet ﷺ, because he is Rasulullah ﷺ, the most just person that has ever lived on this earth, he told the Sahabi, "Yes, it is your right, and you are going to take your right." فَكَشَفَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَنْ بَطْنِهِ. The Prophet ﷺ, he uncovered his belly for this companion, so that the companion can what? Poke back at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam here, and justice will be made. Now, again, second surprising reaction of this companion, he jumped on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hugged him, and then he went and kissed the belly of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he told him, "Ya Rasulullah, I was not looking for any justice or anything like that. It is just that basically the only reason why I made this whole setup is because we are getting into a battle. I don't know, I might die." We all know that a battle usually for a soldier is dangerous, so he might be facing death in a few hours, in a few moments. So he told him, "Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fa'aratu an yakuna akhiru al-ahdi bika an yamassa jildi jildaka." He said, "Ya Rasulullah, I wanted this to be the final thing, that you would be the last person that my skin will touch your skin, basically the last person that I will touch." So he only wanted to kiss the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that's why he made up this whole, again, this whole story here, and he exaggerated and he said, "Ya Rasulullah, you know, I need justice to be made," and so on and so forth. So again, we see here how much the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, they love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there's a very similar story here by another companion. His name is Usayd ibn Hudayr, very famous Sahabi of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they say in the, and both of these narrations, by the way, they are authentic, and this narration is in Sunan Abi Dawood alayhi rahmatullahi ta'ala. Usayd radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, it says in the narration that he was a very funny man, he was a very funny sahabi from the Ansar. فَبَيْنَمَا كَانَ يُحَدِّثُ الْقَوْمَ وَكَانَ فِيهِ مِزَاحٌ فَبَيْنَمَا كَانَ يُضْحِكُهُمْ فَطَعَانَهُ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So once he was saying very funny jokes to his companions, to the people around him, to the men around him, and maybe they, you know, it was a bit too much and they were laughing too loud or something. So the same thing here, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he poked him like this, and he made up the same story. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, I want justice to be made," and so on and so forth, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم allowed him to take his right back, if we can call it so. He just jumped on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and kissed him here, basically on the side, very close to the hip. أو كما جاء في حديث النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام. So this is what we call here, by the way, التبرك, the concept of تبرك. تبرك meaning seeking the barakah, seeking the blessing, but we are talking about a very specific form of تبرك. التبرك بجسد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, seeking blessing through the body of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Okay, this existed in the time of the Sahaba companions, they used to do it. There's no problem with this. This is in many authentic hadith. However, it's important to note here that this hukm, this ruling, is specific to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, so that's why none of the Sahaba after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to do tabarruk through the body of Abu Bakr or Umar or any other basically noble Muslim. So this is specific to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that, you know, if we were alive with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we would have had the right, we would have the right to seek barakah in the body of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum would basically even try to get, you know, the drops of water that come out of the wudu of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even that, there is barakah in it. Allah azza wa jalla has created barakah in it. This is not, you know, something again for the common people. This is only for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for the body of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What about us now? And what about all of those Muslims, even from past generations, that, as it is the case for the vast majority of Muslims, they were not Sahaba, they were not companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Well, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave us also a glad tiding, as it came in Sahih Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he spoke about the believers from future generations, from generations after his time. He said, alayhi salatu wasalam, min ashaddi ummati li hubban nasun yakununa ba'di yawaddu ahaduhum law ra'ani bi ahlihi wa malihi. He said, alayhi salatu wasalam, among the people from my ummah, from my community, among the people who love me the most are people who will come after me, meaning after the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and one of them would wish to basically purchase an opportunity, the chance of seeing me. He would wish to give his money and his family for that. So meaning someone that loves the Prophet ﷺ so much that he wishes he could see the Prophet ﷺ, he could meet the Prophet ﷺ, even if he had to give his family and to give his wealth for that. So this is in Sahih Muslim. This is a glad tiding, or a great here announcement and bushra from Rasulullah ﷺ, that whoever loves the Prophet ﷺ truly and has a truthful love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they don't necessarily have to be from only the time of the Sahaba who lived with the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam. Now, we have another question here, very important, which is, what does it mean to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What are the implications? Notice that loving Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not just an emotional thing. It's not just a state that we express with our words. We say "Uhibbu Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam." I love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No, it goes beyond that. It has implications, because this is, let's remember, this is a religion. This is a religion. This is Deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So first of all, first major implication of loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is following the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. To follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. In Surah Al-Imran, Allah Azza wa Jal says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Say, if you truly love Allah, then follow me, فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ, and Allah Azza wa Jal, He will love you in return and forgive your sins. يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, because Allah Azza wa Jal, He is the all-forgiving, all-merciful. And then He says, subhanahu وتعالى قل أطيعوا الله والرسول فإن تولوا فإن الله لا يحب الكافرين. Say, obey Allah and His Messenger, and if they turn away, whoever doesn't want to obey Allah and His Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, what happens? Allah عز وجل says, فإن الله لا يحب الكافرين. Allah عز وجل, He does not love the kafirin. So the true mu'minin, they are not like the kafirin. They love to follow Allah or to follow Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and to obey Allah سبحانه وتعالى and His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. It's not a random following here, or a random obedience, part-time obedience from time to time. No, it is an absolute obedience. الطاعة المطلقة لله تعالى ولرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's why in Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah Azza wa Jal says, this is first ayah in Surah Al-Hujurat, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله واتقوا الله. Allah Azza wa Jal says, لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله. Meaning, all you who believe, don't put anything before Allah and His Messenger. Ibn Abbas, very famous companion, cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he explains this ayah from Surah Al-Hujurat, he says, أي لا تقولوا خلاف الكتاب والسنة. Do not speak with things that go against Kitab, Book of Allah Azza wa Jal, as well as Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the prophetic tradition of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is what Iman is all about. For some people, again, some people who claim that they are Muslims, when a verse from the Quran, ayah from the Book of Allah Azza wa Jal, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is quoted in front of them, they say, I heard this before, I know it's in the Quran. However, what I think, what I believe, or however there is a thinker who said, however there is, for example, an author who said, and they say the same thing with hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is not Iman, this is not true Islam. Okay, this is a sign of nifaq, iyadha billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the true mu'min doesn't put anything before Allah Azza wa Jal and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. لا تقول خلاف الكتاب والسنة, Book of Allah Azza wa Jal, and then Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what loving Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam means. Second of all, loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also means what? Supporting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, defending the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, standing with the message and with the religion of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah Azza wa Jal, He calls this what? Being the Ansar of Allah Azza wa Jal. Ansar meaning the supporters, just like we have Sahaba who are known as the Ansar, so Sahaba from Medina who welcomed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who hosted him and the rest of the companions who came from Mecca, they were all hosted by the Ansar, the Sahaba of the Medina, because they supported Ansaru Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now we have to be the Ansar of the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. This is not optional, this is part of loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is what Islam says, but also this is what the reason says, this is what our fitrah says. You see, nowadays a lot of people, especially in the, for example, in the Arab countries, people, they go crazy about some sports teams. For example, they support their favorite team, and they support it so much. They have so much love for that team that for some people, although they say that they are Muslims, they go to the extent, for example, of cutting their family ties, using some very bad words, haram words, cursing, having problems with their neighbors. All of that for what? Just for a ball, for soccer or football, as they call it in Europe and in the Arab countries. Why? Because they are so passionate about that team or about that sport. They tell you, I love it so much, I have to defend it. Now, the same person, when we are talking about Islam, they say, I love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I love Allah azza wa jalla so much, I love the Quran. But then when they are asked to stand up for Islam, for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his religion, they say, no, Allah azza wa jal knows I love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's not a truthful love. That's why Allah azza wa jal, he says in the Quran al-Kareem, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُونُوا أَنصَارَ اللَّهِ كَمَا قَالَ عِيسَى بْنُ مَرْيَمَ لِلْحَوَارِيِّينَ مَنْ أَنصَارِي إِلَى اللَّهِ قَالَ الْحَوَارِيُّونَ نَحْنُ أَنصَارُ اللَّهِ فَآمَنَ الطَّائِفَةٌ مِنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ وَكَفَرَ الطَّائِفَةٌ فَأَيَّدْنَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَى عَدُوِّهِمْ فَأَصْبَحُوا ظَاهِرِينَ. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he tells us to be the Ansar of Allah Azza wa Jal, supporters of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then he mentions the example of Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, Isa ibn Maryam. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَمَا قَالَ عِيسَى ابْنُ مَرْيَمَ, when Isa, he spoke to the Hawariyin, to his apostles or his Sahaba, if we can call them so, Sahaba of Isa alayhi salam, he told them what? Man ansari ilallah, who are my supporters to Allah azza wa jal, meaning for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they say, nahnu ansarullah, they said, we are the ansar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I will conclude here with this very, very strong and powerful, very straightforward ayah in the Quran Kareem in Surah At-Tawbah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us basically a warning that if we just prefer this dunya over defending Islam, defending Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending us here a warning and threatening us that we might become fasiqeen, iyadan billahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are not true mu'mineen. Qala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قل إن كان آباؤكم وأبناؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا حتى وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الْفَاسِقِينَ. So this is a very powerful ayah that can be found again in Surah At-Tawbah, in Surah Bara'ah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's telling us here that we have to be very careful not to be so busy with our families and our relationships and our money and our business and our houses and so on and so forth, and then we forget to defend the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or we become unable to do so again because we have so much attachment to the dunya. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam, sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.